Thank you so much for being here. Thank you for coming to Right On by Final Draft at NYFA.
Yeah! Hell yeah!
So I'm your host, Pete D'Alessandro. I'm the product manager at Final Draft, but I also host this lovely podcast called Right On. I thank all of you for coming to NYFA tonight to talk to us and to listen to us. We have a great guest tonight. I am really excited. He's written on Grimm, Altered Carbon, and a bunch of other stuff. Nevin Densham, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you very much for having me. Appreciate it, Pete.
So we're going to be talking about, you know, careers and how you got started and all that, and we'll definitely get into some Altered Carbon, but as a courtesy to me, please, for the love of God, no spoilers.
Okay.
All right.
Right.
So I would like to just start with, you know, we usually start with how you got into writing and how you knew you were going to get into writing.
Well, you know, I grew up where my dad was a Hollywood director, writer, producer, so I had a gigantic leg up. And I was mentored from a very early age on story and a love for storytelling. And I can remember my dad wrote Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves, and he told me it as a bedtime story about the time I was 10 or 9, you know, and he had seen, this is going to be a little bit long-winded, but long story short, he, at the time, in the late 80s, a version of a hero was a man who killed other men. And he did not want me to be raised seeing that is what a hero was. A hero was a man who fought for other people, even though you didn't necessarily get what you wanted. Selfishness versus, you know, being selfless. And from a really early age, like, those kinds of things were made really clear to me because it was just what he believed. And then growing up around that kind of thoughtful storytelling, it wasn't just, hey, let's make a buck. It was, how do you tell a story that matters? You know, how do you do something that hopefully leaves a little good left in the world? And, you know, I was encouraged to write. I was encouraged to write poetry. I was encouraged to read a lot. And, you know, to study history, because history was a story. It's better than our fake story, you know? Like, you can find almost anything through history, and you will find wonderful human connections. And the thing about storytelling that I fell in love with was the ability to express myself, to be hopefully a little vulnerable, you know, and actually dig deeper than I could by studying math, and maybe leave a mark behind me if I'm so lucky. And you know, the world is filled with fantastic storytellers, and so there is nothing really special about me. But what I found I could do was I could sit in a room and I could go, oh, but what if he did this? How about that? And then what about this line of dialogue? And then what if the hero had this emotion? Because the reality of writing for, like, TV, at least, is it's such a long process. What ends up being really, really critical is getting great ideas expressed succinctly and hopefully being able to pull them off. And fitting that inside of a box, inside of my head there's a Lego box of story. And I literally think through it like a Lego set. And I go, what is the thing we're building today? And I loved Legos as a kid, and I have the same gestaltish joy of trying to make a Millennium Falcon from scratch by digging it through a box and, you know, trying to put it together and put all those pieces and turn them around and see if they fit. And I'm good at that. I'm really good at that. And that is another incredibly gratifying thing, is when you can find something you're good at. And I'm not a great writer. I'm a good writer, but I'm a great story breaker, and I loved it. I love it so much.
Wow, that's great. All right, so let's talk about college and the kind of beginning of the career.
Well, went to college in Lewiston, Maine, Bates College, little liberal arts, you know, thing. You know, I'm American, British, Canadian. I have three passports. My mom was from Toronto, my dad was from England, and I was born in LA. And I wanted to go somewhere that was not LA for school, and I grew up in LA. And so going to Maine, where it's cold, you know, you have fall and there's snow, which is fantastic because I love my Canadian winters when I was going back for Christmas. So I studied sociology, and the thing that I thought I was going to study history or maybe rhetoric, and, you know, you go to college, you have no idea what you're going to do. Never wanted to study English because I always thought, I do that for fun. I don't want to have to write essays. I want to read books and just have fun enjoying them as, you know, for me in my mind. But I met a great professor, long story short, which is going to be a lot of these long story shorts, you know, classic professor inspired me about what it meant to study sociology, and it was just this pursuit of meaning. And I think a really good story, you know, like the way that I took what I learned in sociology, I studied qualitative, which is where you have an interview, you talk to people, you tell a story, or you dig one out of someone, or you try to get to know them better. By the way, all of that is useful when you work in Hollywood. You know, being able to talk to people and figure out what they're interested in and why is sort of the day job of being a TV writer. It's the day job of being an executive. It's the day job of being a development. Because you're constantly searching for the meaning so that, you know, you help express it. And I loved being able to talk to somebody and maybe 5 or 10 somebodies and ask the same questions and get a broad kind of understanding of whatever the hell it was I was studying. And for me, I studied the construction of gender and maintenance self in online first-person shooter games because I loved playing violent first-person shooter games. And I can remember a dude being like, you know, forgive me for saying this out loud, but I shot him in a game, and he goes, who's a fag now, bitch, after he killed me next, and then teabagged me, if you know what that is, and had a macro of all these things. And I was like, what the hell does that mean? And I was allowed to try to find out. I don't really know what it meant, other than it was an attempt to be masculine. But the whole like idea of finding, like, that's a crazy random thing, right? Like, that I can remember that, and that has left a mark on me that moment. And forgetting whether that mark is relevant to anything at all, the fact that that mark left a mark in my mind, and I still think about it when I tell story, is, you know, again, what I think like I learned the most from college of anything other than how to hang out with people, was some things should resonate, and why. And if you can figure out what resonates inside of you and why, then you have a lot of really good fodder to begin. And I constantly do that work, I do that every day in the writer's room where we're trying to figure out what story are we telling and why. And that is a thing I've been studying and thinking critically about since I was, 19. At least for school. What was the other side of the, question? When I first
College, and then what happened when you came out of college?
Graduated, and my dad said, what do you want to be, director, writer, producer? And I had a panic attack because I didn't want to be anything, and I didn't know how to be anything. And my skill set was I talk. I studied sociology. I don't have a job. What do you do? And my dad is successful asking me a very difficult question. And I came back to LA, and I wanted to roll phones because I didn't know how to do that. And I wanted to take notes because I didn't know how to do that. And I didn't know anything, frankly. I knew how to go have a meeting with a top-level executive and talk and not be intimidated, but I could not answer a phone. And I knew that was a fatal flaw. Because if I don't know how to do what the assistant does, the PA does, I don't know anything. Because I really don't. I'm just another arrogant asshole who got up-jumped, and I didn't earn it. So I wanted to start very low, and I got to roll phones, and I got to work in development, and I accidentally sold something where they assumed I was a writer, because I was a development exec, but I was my father's son, and they assumed I was a writer. And that way that I became, because I'd always been asked to help rewrite my dad's scripts, and so I was constantly privy to a very collaborative process and a very safe process, and one where my opinion mattered at 20, 21, 22, all this like. Making me feel like I actually have anything to contribute is really valuable and powerful because it gives you faith, which is hard to have when you're creative. And I can remember, Development Exec, there's a book that's cool. We option it. We're going to try to get MGM to buy it. And I pitch the top of the president of MGM, and I pitch another guy below him, and I pitch another guy below him, and then I pitch the president of UA, and then another guy at UA. And then an offer comes in for me to write it. And I'm like, I'm trying to hire a writer to do that, and also I have no idea how to do that, no idea what to do with an agent, no idea how to do any of this, but I had written the treatment because I wanted to sell it, and I'd pitched my heart out of it because I believed in it, and they thought I meant to write it, and so I did, long story short, which is, again, not true, and it was terrible because it was fucking terrible, it's the first script I ever wrote on my own, and it was really bad, and people kept saying, oh, it's pretty good, I'm like, no, I know it's bad. And I can remember having a moment, and this is the one, like, I know it's bad, but also I might win an Oscar. If you're a writer, I'm sure you've had that moment where you've written something, you're like, I just might be a genius. Am I a genius? And then very quickly you realize I am not. and there are notes. And it never gets made. And you spend years of your life trying to get it made and rewriting it with directors, with other producers, and it never gets made. And you never get paid again. For the same work, and you die on that hill, and that sucked. So I hate working in film, And I learned development, you know, working under my dad and his partners, and I liked development, but also I liked writing, but I hated writing, because when you're writing, you're alone. Mm-hmm. And the great thing about TV was you're in a room with people, and, you know, preferably they're not assholes, but, you know, most of the time, almost every writer I've worked with in TV has been a really good person and helpful and collaborative and really invested, and they don't want to destroy you. So that's been great. When I graduated college, here's another like side story. I joined a Dungeons and Dragons gaming group because the writer's PA, and I was rolling calls at that point. The writer's PA had the two books, the DM's Guide and the Player's Handbook. And he said, yeah, some of the other writers, they go and they play, and you should come join us. And I'm like, I haven't played since second grade. I can't believe this. They're adults. I'm a kid. And I went and I played, and some of those guys turned out to be Ashley Miller and Zach Stentz, who wrote Thor and X-Men First Class, and are now very AAA feature film writers. And one of the DMs is a guy that created Andromeda, who's been on recently one of the co-EPs of Elementary. And you know, I also had a different storytelling experience, no joke, from Dungeons & Dragons, with great storytellers. Another guy was a rocket scientist, so a whole other point of view. But this little crowd of dudes who were just totally okay with a 22-year-old asshole coming in and hanging out with their 32-year-old selves, and then giving me great advice, and the greatest advice I learned from them was go write in TV. If you feel like quitting, try TV, because at the very least, something will probably get made, you'll probably get paid, and you'll work with other people.
Wow. Yeah. That all came true.
Yeah, I mean, it took a long time. I actually also, in the midst of all of that, like transitioning from working in development for my dad and his partners, I started taking night courses at UCLA. I took three at UCLA for TV, and one with one of the teachers in a smaller group as well, and all around like a period of a year and a year and a half, because I knew nothing about the structure of TV. I didn't know how to do a beat sheet. I didn't know what an outline was. I didn't know why you would outline. I didn't know how to talk about the five-act structure. I didn't know what a teaser was. I didn't know what the reasoning behind the concept of a teaser. So, but I did have good story sense, and I had, you know, I'm a pretty decent writer, and I like talking, and so I took those courses, and I learned how to write somebody else's TV show, which was NCIS, because I loved NCIS. I wrote my own pilot, and another one of my own pilots, and then I was like, I actually know how to do this now. It's pretty good. And failed for another couple years to get a job in TV until I wrote a really good pilot. And my wife, who at the time was my girlfriend, had been through the process that I had of trying to figure that out, that pilot that made my career. And, you know, gave me really good notes and was there for me when I was horribly depressed and figured I had no chance and I should just quit. And I finished it, and you know, she read it, and she liked it, and had some notes. I gave it to one of the other guys from the Dungeons & Dragons group. Then I gave it to Lita Caligridis, and I've known Lita since I was 15. Again, I have these huge legs up, so I'm sorry. I have a lot of insecurity, so that helps weigh it. But I've known Lita, and she was one of the people that my dad trusted for his early work, because she didn't destroy it. She wanted to build it up, because she cared about you. And she would see the good and not focus on the bad. So I gave her the pilot, and she said, this is really good. Can I give it to my agent? And I didn't have an agent. I had a crappy manager. I hadn't been on one meeting.
That's not a great manager.
Not a good manager. And she gave it to a guy named Paul Haas, who is one of the presidents of TV at WME. And he liked it. And I don't know if he liked it because I wrote it and it was good, or if he liked it because Lita Caligridis was giving it to him. But he liked it, and I was in WME within a week, and wow. I was signed, and I was put onto Grimm, given a freelance, like, in almost no time. But I had something, I'd done the 10 years of learning to write, you know, like, even though I had all these legs up, I'd been, you know, I hadn't had a real job until I was probably 32, staffed on Grimm. Freelanced on Grimm. Oof. Which was like, oh my gosh, I'm making money, and I have a career, and then, you know, don't work again for 6 months or whatever. But and that was like hugely critical, was that validation from somebody who said, this is really good enough, and I'm going to tell somebody.
That is fantastic. I mean, that's the thing you're hoping for when you actually show a script to somebody, is that they'll pass it on. So what happened? I mean, Grimm was one season, and then what did you wind up doing next?
I know I did Defiance. Mm-hmm. So I did second season of Defiance as a staff writer, and then I did the only season of Heroes Reborn as a staff writer. And then I was on nothing until Altered Carbon. And I was actually up for a show called Zoo on CBS, which don't knock it. I loved it. Actually, it was like, Zoo's kind of great. It's Walking Dead with animals. It's fucking amazing. I felt like I got the joke. And I'm really enthusiastic about things. You know, when I love something, I'm excited by something, I just go. And I went in and I pitched those guys. And so they wanted to hire me. And the day I was supposed to get an offer, this is a Hollywood story, but the day I was going to get the offer to work on Zoo and get a bump and get a script, and like, it's amazing. So I was going to be a story editor. I got a call from Lita saying, hey, have you heard about, you know, this book, Altered Carbon? I wrote a feature. I would love to have your thoughts on it if I was to do it as a TV show. And I said, well, sure, but, you know, I love the book. I've read all three in the series because I love sci-fi. But I'm probably going to get an offer today to be on something else. And then she called me and said, please don't. Because it was a secret that this was happening. You know, that there's a deal with Netflix about the book, and it was almost sealed. But you can't tell anybody. But you are going to have to tell your agents to turn down the offer for a secret deal that isn't guaranteed. Yeah. And I hadn't worked in I don't know how long. I know it felt like forever. Probably was only 4 or 5, 8 months. But, you know, I was going, man, I have this much money saved. I don't want to be a burden to my wife or to my family. But also, I trust Lita. And I really trust Lita. And, you know, she'd done really good by me. And it wasn't just so much that, it's like, also, I love the book. And what she was talking about wanting to do for it, the level at which she wanted to do it and at which they would let her do it was tremendous. And there's a CBS show that's fun, and a chance to go work on something really, hopefully different and big, and hopefully meaningful, you know, not just another punch 'em, kick 'em show, but there's something deeper that was constantly trying to be explored at the very least from the top, and that Netflix had buy-in, Skydance had buy-in, and all the writers had buy-in, and the actors had buy-in, and, you know, and so I did that, and a couple months go by, doesn't happen. And I'm going, I have fucked my life. And then that Christmas, December 15, it's happening. The deal closes. And so Lita and I started working in her office, in her house, breaking the first season. And we broke all 10 eps in about 2.5 weeks. But that's the benefit of a book, and a really well-structured book. Mm-hmm. And, of course, everything changed as soon as we started, you know, with real writers. But being able to start coming in, and we had carted. So imagine behind me, all of this, carted, floor to ceiling, oof. You know? And not scenes, but sort of like, hey, Takeshi does this. And, you know, oh, who's going to be Raylene? And why? Oh, she's going to be, maybe she'd be the sister instead of this random person. If you read the book, she's not the sister. Sorry, spoilers. Shit. How many spoilers should I?
I mean, that was the one, right? Damn, that was the right. Mulligan. Yeah.
Well, anyway, a lot of the big concept stuff was done in that room, and I'm a huge fan of being able to work with somebody who can say yes or no. And so she's able to go, no, or yeah, let's try that. And then you bring in other people, and then you sandpaper the shit out of that. And sometimes you chop it to pieces and do it again.
Wow. So what did it mean to become a story editor? For people that don't know, I mean, you were a staff writer a couple times.
Yeah, so it's no different, except, and critically, when you're a story editor, and every title above that, you get paid for your scripts. So when you're a staff writer, technically you're being paid, but it's against your salary. So you get a weekly, which is amazing. You feel like you're rich. You write an episode, and the value of the episode is put against the total amount of money you've been paid on staff, and usually it's significantly less than the amount of money you've been paid, so you don't get paid for the script. You get your name on it, but that's it. And when you're a story editor, then your name goes on every ep, and the back title's somewhere buried. So your name's on all of the show, because you're technically supposed to be contributing to every episode and breaking on every episode. Not that a staff writer doesn't, but you have a hierarchy, and thus, you know, something like that. And you get paid for every script you write. And that is fantastically, like, morally just validating, you know? Because you're going to do the same work as a staff writer and a story editor. And the difference is, one, you get the credit and the money, and the other, you just get the credit. So I don't even understand why. It's just the way it is. And then in the middle of the first season, I was promoted to executive story editor, which means nothing different, as far as I can tell. I don't think I got a pay bump, as far as I can tell. I have a title bump, so okay, cool. And then if there's a second season, I can't tell you anything. I will be a co-producer, and that'll be cool.
That'll be great. So what's the rest of the composition of the writer's room on Ultra Carbon like? How many people are there?
For the first season, it's Lita. Her co-showrunner was Steve Blackman. And then Russ and Garrett. So I know them either as Russ and Garrett or Friend and Lerner. I believe it is Russell Friend and Garrett Lerner, who are also EPs. EP is like, you know, you're in charge. It goes EP, co-EP, and then down from there. So those guys are all EPs, including Lita, who's the showrunner. And then Brian Nelson, who's a co-EP. Brian Nelson wrote Hard Candy, if any of you know that. It's like the best calling card I can give you. He's fucking crazy. He's awesome. Russ and Garrett, they were EPs on House for like from the second season. And Steve has worked on a whole bunch of, like, he's on Fargo and got Legion and tons of years before that in TV that I can't remember. And then there was me, and I was a story editor. And I'm in a room full of fucking EPs. And I'm the guy that's supposed to tell them what the story is because I worked on it with the showrunner. And I know the book. They don't know the book. You know, I've spent months prepping, and they just got hired. And so I was incredibly lucky that they were generous to a fucking nobody. But I also do a great job. You know, I will give myself as much credit as I deserve, and I can play at their level when it came to breaking the story and working the story with them and explaining why it was and why the characters were this way, and then hearing their ideas and going, that actually works. And I'm the fucking story editor. Being like, yeah, Kovach could do that because in this, in the book, and then I know Lito likes this. And so we can try to make it work. But that was, it was mind-blowing. You know, and there was a day, there was very, very early on, Lito brought us all together in a room and said, I have a room full of EPs, including him. And I'm like, now I'm fucking embarrassed because I have huge imposter syndrome. And then you just start working. You know, and then you prove it or you don't. And I was lucky enough to prove it. And, you know, I co-wrote the finale. And I had my own ep in the middle. And I said, none of that's guaranteed. All that was earned. And I co-wrote 107, which for me is actually my favorite episode because it's the reveal of the villain. I don't know if you've watched the show, but I love 107 just creatively. It's so much fun to actually, the final execution of it was actually way better than on the page. I don't know, is that sort of...
Yeah, I think so. And that's it. I mean, I think we covered the composition of the writer's room. And I mean, how long were you guys working in that?
I started December 15 unofficially. We were picked up, I think, second week of January 2016. And I worked all of 2016 and then through roughly half of 2017. And then July 2017, we started to think about second season stuff. I took a deliberate break after it ended because we were writing the whole time, because when you think about, I can't tell you the budget of the show, but it's like a movie, and it's huge. You know, it's a couple hundred people at least. I don't remember how big the crew is, but it was gigantic, and it was ambitious, and you run into production realities, weather realities. Oh, shoot, we thought we were going to do this in the story, but this is better realities. And so we were rewriting as we were shooting because you'd find better stuff where you'd have to do it, or you'd realize this doesn't work, we gotta go make it work, or something can't be produced this way because the building doesn't, you know, have that high of a ceiling, or whatever it is, all of the traditional problems. And so we did a lot of work making it work. And I gotta say, the hardest working person was Lita. Mm-hmm. I mean, I work pretty hard, but I get paid to do that. She basically is putting her body and soul into the film, the TV show, out of pure passion at a certain point, because there's only so much money you can get paid and for so many hours, and she just doesn't stop. Mm. It's insane. I don't know how she does it, but she just keeps going, and she refuses to have it be mediocre. You know, there's a lot of temptation, and I have this temptation in spades of, I'm done. I will be done. Here you go. And her version of being done is when it's cut.
It's not to let go and not to let go of that quality.
No, nope. You do not settle for something that could be better.
Right.
And that's why it's good.
Well, that's a good way to segue into the production. I mean, we were starting to touch on what those production realities are, but how did the whole crew come together? How did you guys shoot? What are the details?
I mean, I don't know all the details because I was the executive story editor. But you hire a fantastic actor, fantastic actresses. You go straight for casting first. Their rival at Joel was he was able to do the character. And he was able to do that physically and emotionally. He could be a threat. He could be full of pathos. And he had a big enough name that they felt like it was worth putting a show on him. And then you go for fantastic supporting actors, and there's a gigantic process in trying to find them. And, you know, you're looking for certain character traits, and you're looking for certain people at a certain level, and you're looking for someone who can do a great job. And that ultimately shakes out, and I think it shook out pretty well. Netflix had certain asks because they would like to have an international presence. So if you've seen the show, you may have noticed there's people speaking other languages and having accents. And being ethnically diverse as much as we can physically manage to get it in screen, and that's on purpose. You know, those are all active choices. I cannot pronounce Martha's last name, but Kristen Ortega is the actress. They wanted someone who could speak Spanish with a Mexican accent and be from Mexico and be a star and punch people and, you know, and act in English. And so, like, that's a huge thing to lay on somebody. And by the way, you're going to be doing it for a year of your life. So, casting, critical. But also, very early on, they hired a guy named Carrie Meyer, who was, forget his official title, so forgive me, Carrie, if you ever help, you know, listen to this. Set design, all the design work. So, all that world building, the street, the pill, the head in the clouds, the arium, all of the color palette, all of the things that you see, the whole of the raven, you know, all of that. He is creating that and shaping that with Lita's guidance. And that is a gigantic amount of work. And very early on, he was brought in to help figure that out. Because, you know, that's huge. Costume designer, whose name I forget, so I'm an asshole. She's huge, incredibly talented. You know, there are times you'd have maybe 100 extras who'd have to be costumed. But you'd also have to have hero costumes for two different time periods. Because there's two Kovaches, one in the past, one in the present. You know, be able to do rich and poor and all of it in between. And pull it off at a level where you can... We shot in 4K because Netflix wanted it in 4K. So it has to be able to hold up. You can't, like, bury the lead inside of it. It's going to be there. Gosh, I don't know what else. I mean, the physical production, daunting. We ran two first units. We'd be shooting two episodes at the same time. There was a moment in time where we were even shooting one of our second units as a first unit to play catch-up because things just happen, you know? When you're shooting a lot of stuff, some things fall out, and so you got to pick it up somewhere. And so you do. And it was the actors. I cannot believe the amount of physical endurance and emotional endurance you have to do that. Because we're shooting a lot of nights, and if you've ever worked on anything in production, shooting nights fucking sucks for everybody, and you just work and work and work and work, but you love it, you know, and you're doing good work, and you can see it, so you just keep going. You know, shot in Vancouver for lots of different reasons, largely because there's fantastic crews in Vancouver, and you get really good credits, tax credits. They could find a building, Skydance leased a building. It was ever seen a newspaper facility where they print newspapers? They leased one of those, an old one, and they ripped it out and built a studio for the show. So we had, I think, three stages, if not four stages, one of which was the run. The run is a 300-foot long, 40-foot tall, I think it was 40 feet tall, interior street, because that's where you would print newspaper. So you just rip all that out, and then you set deck that sucker. They made it rain in there, also. I don't know how. And then you would shoot those city streets practically on an interior set you owned. Insane. You know, we had our costumes below it, and that was as long as it. Mm. And then, like, the Raven was built on stage. Psychosec was built on stage. Good gosh, I'm blanking on my character names. Elliot, his place, built on stage. As much as possible, built on stage, because then you can control it, and you can shoot it again. And if something goes wrong, you don't have to get the hell out of there. You can finish if you have to. And then also a lot of it was shot in Vancouver because Vancouver has, you know, they're a place that shoots a lot. So there's a lot of comfort and ease with getting your permits. And also for all the stuff for like 107, the flashbacks in on Harlan's World, that's upstate or up province from Vancouver. And so, you know, you can go do that. You can go find incredible vistas and shoot them. So I don't know, is that sort of...
Yes, I mean, there's a lot of benefit. All right. Yeah. Well, I'd like to take it to the audience now if you guys have questions. There's a mic right there, so go ahead and you can stand up and grab that mic.
Hey, so when you first started Altered Carbon, it was December 15th. When did you go from that point with the showrunner to shooting? What was your first day of shooting from that time period? How much time was that?
I think it was September. I can't remember. I know we were done December 2016 for the pilot, just the pilot. The prep for the season and the pilot began, I want to say June-ish, but I don't know. Because I honestly, it was a year of working. And at a certain point, it just all turns into one day. Yeah. I'm pretty sure it was September. I feel like it was a 30-day shoot.
So that's when you were
in Vancouver, hard prep,
right?
Was September, maybe. I don't really remember. I'm sorry. But no, basically, maybe. Fall, winter was when we were in production. And then they shot all through 2017 until, I want to say, June, July.
Perfect. Thank you.
Hi. I started watching Altered Carbon because of Joel Kinnaman, who I love from The Killing. And I stayed for how wonderful it was. I loved it from the first moment. And I didn't binge it in a weekend, but it was about 10 days. So I wanted to ask you about the female characters. There are very, very strong female characters in a wide range, which is very exciting, especially in this era in cinema and television history. And yet, this show has gotten some accusations about misogyny, and it doesn't feel like the typical Hollywood treating women as objects who have no name and girlfriend number four or what have you. I should also say that I am halfway through the book, which I'm loving, and I would love for you to talk about the development of the female characters, especially given your background in sociology.
Well, I can't really speak to it about the background of sociology, per se, for the show, because I haven't thought about that yet. It takes some thinking. But as for the whole, like, the controversy of it all, one, Lita should be answering that because it is her show. And what she did was what she chose to do. But I can tell you from my experience inside of the room, what we were deliberately trying to do was show a world where the violence against women was reprehensible. And so, you know, the arc behind Mary, I'm trying not to spoil it, but there's a character named Mary Lou who falls and dies. And the way in which she is used and abused and thrown away, mirrored with what happens to Lizzie, who is used and abused and thrown away. By the way, both of whom killed by women who are villains and have very clear goals and really powerful emotional reasons for why. The goal was to go, this is ugly. And so for me personally, when someone is saying is misogynist, I get frustrated about that, only because it was really not the intent. You know, we weren't putting the violence out there, at least, in order to have us go, yay. You know, I go back to what I said about how my dad raised me, mm-hmm. and when he saw movies in the 80s that were all about men killing men, and that was a bad version of a hero. And a good version of a hero is someone who saves other people. Kovach may not live up to that, but he is not a man just going around killing people for fun. He is a man who is motivated. And it's specifically his backstory, the thing that I loved about that male character was Takeshi saw his dad murder his mom, mm-hmm. and he refused to ever have that happen again. And he struck his dad down in vengeance for and out of love for his sister. And that is sort of like the original sin, but it's also why he's a hero to me, is there are lines he won't cross, and there's a formulative experience that makes very clear emotional sense. And it is one of the things that when he is faced to work with people or work in opposition to people who do violence against women, he gets angry because that isn't who he is. You know, and so that hopefully that works. But then, you know, there's a whole, like, you know, what Renee was playing, you know, they were playing Kel Gris Falconer. Mm-hmm. The hero of the revolution is a black lady.
Yes, you know? She is.
And she is the badass person who teaches Kovach to love, also to kick ass, and gives him a chance to redeem himself. And he fails her. And, you know, she is this memory of what could have been and should have been, but she's not an icon on a pedestal. She's someone who lives and breathes and, you know, espouses a contrarian point of view to the world that our hero has dropped into. And she's right from one point of view, certainly. I debate about Kel with Lita a lot because she wants to bring back death. And is that a good thing? But, you know, the argument is pretty valid. And then there's Kristen Ortega, you know, the hopefully not our archetypical gumshoe detective. But,
she's, you know, wonderful.
She kicks.
Oh, my God. She's amazing.
She had a family, you know? Like, she cares about something more than just... One of those, like, tests you're supposed to do is, does she have drive other than the man? And she kind of walks the line because she is interested in getting the sleeve back and saving her boyfriend's life. But she's not there to save Kovach. She's not there to be Joel's love interest. That isn't why she's in the show from her point of view. And she wouldn't articulate that. And, they walk away at the... Fuck, sorry, dude. They walk away.
I've seen it.
Sorry, spoilers. You know, they walk away from each other at the end as an act of choice because I don't actually love you. So there's a lot of, like... And I can keep going, you know. Yeah. All of that thought out and deliberately chosen. Oh, and by the way, it's run by a woman. You know, and it's not just that she's a woman so she can't be, you know, misogynist. Is that she's very politically active in opposition to misogyny and consciously trying to do, hey, look, this shit is ugly. What rich motherfuckers are doing, taking advantage of women, be it today or then, or in our story world, is ugly. And take a look. So that, I think, hopefully that answers. So did I forget anything?
I think that's a great answer. And I also think it really speaks to the fact that anyone who just watches the pilot and makes snap judgments based on the pilot needs to keep watching because the show's doing a lot more. That's a great answer. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay, I have two parts. First one, tell us about the script that got you into WME. And second question is, there's been a lot of talk about the pacing of this. Some say it's a little too slow, some say it's a little too fast. Talk about how you regulated the story so that the pacing was kind of even.
Right, so I'll answer the second one first. The pacing is very much based on how the book handed it out. And we never turned up, we never felt the need to turn up the dial or turn back the dial because we had a lot of really organic, I mean, like it was weird, but it was organically pure ends of episodes that hooked you. And, you know, if the content in the middle gets a little slow, I mean, that just sort of happens. And hopefully what you're doing is you're delivering either drama or action or humor and everything in between. And you want to stay and play inside of this world. Oh, and by the way, we've hooked you because whatever endpoint we ended on, you want to see more. For Netflix's obvious, you know, can we keep you watching for hours? So structurally, book, that's pacing, largely book. And largely because if you needed to have something to explain, for example, you know, make Ortega a deeper character by giving her a family and exploring that family. And then we end up with Abuela, you know, where we get to have a tremendous actor whose name I should know and I don't, play so many different characters, interact with all of our protagonists. And Ortega, you get to understand her religion, her loss of faith. All of that is new, you know, and her mother, her uncle, her nieces and nephews, all of whom the villain comes after and puts in check and kills some of them. You get to meet them and care about them like she does. That's additive, so if that takes more time, you hope you make it good. But, you know, sometimes it just takes more time. And then the thing I wrote was a sci-fi western slash fantasy based in a near future post-apocalyptic America where magics come back into the world, but only for a small segment who are marginalized, hunted down, and killed. And technology advanced a little bit. And it's about a man running from a version of responsibility where we work for some bad people to save a son-like character who has magic. And they want him, the bad guys. And so he flees to a town called Littlesmith. And the script was called Littlesmith. And he gets there, and he's very unwelcome because he's an outsider, but he's brought a boy there. And there's personal problems, and things come after them. But the thing that worked about it was I spent a lot of time trying to figure. I love Shadowrun. I love Dungeons & Dragons. I love a whole bunch of like mashup stuff for fantasy and sci-fi. That's why I love Altered Carbon, is it fits just a little bit on that sci-fi edge. And I just did what I wanted. You know, I've been trying to write something that would make me a hit. And I can remember, I was house sitting at my folks' house in bed and late at night and going, I just want to make it sound like it's the Old West. And I made the protagonist have a twang, you know, like it just, it, not literally saying he's got a twang, but just letting the fluidity of his words come out in a way that does not make sense if I'm talking about at the time, like 2010, 2012. But it made sense if it was Colorado future, Wild West vibe, post-apocalyptic. Sure, why not? And that voice let me open up, and I just kept giving myself permission. And, you know, it was well enough written that I was not laughed at. but also, again, like 10 years of writing and rewriting other things and learning to write, and then finally just being like, and I'd done that before. I wrote a Genghis Khan script, by the way, that I fucking love. Never gonna get made because I'm a white dude writing a Genghis Khan script that I wish could be shot in Mongolian. not ever gonna happen. But I gave myself permission on that story to write what I wanted, which was a boy becomes king, you know, and a coming of age story set in a world that I've never heard much about it, and then really exploring it. And I did a similar sort of give myself permission for the pilot. And so those are like my two favorite things I've ever written, for me at least. You know, the things that I just said, yeah, sure, I'll try it.
Thank you so much. Keep up the great work.
Thank you.
All right, we got Jason.
Yeah, hi. Nice. I'm Jason again. Hi again.
Hi, Jason. Thanks for the applause earlier.
Not a problem. I'll do it again afterwards. I'm actually a current filmmaker here at NYFA, and I'm extremely interested in being in TV. I think you just answered two of my questions before even getting up here, so I'll modify it a little bit. I follow a script consultant named Lucy Hayes. I'm not sure if anybody knows this. Some of her blogs, there was one that stuck out in particular, and she's like, you'd never want your script to be called derivative. And it doesn't sound like your previous one was very like, I like anything else. So I guess my question is, how much out there should we be throwing ourselves as far as story?
My advice is be out there to the degree that you're comfortable with. Want to be.
When I say this, like, you got hired from your script to be in a TV room, but not because of your script. So, in a sense, not because of the story, but because, you know, I'm just going to guess.
Well, for Altered Carbon?
No.
When they actually signed me, yeah. And, you know, were like, hey, we're going to try to make money on you. 90% should, well, there's two, like, completely separate silos of what make you a good writer. One is you have to be able to sell you. And you have to be you to the most you can be, and as interestingly and effervescently, or at least marketably, as you can be, which means if I'm going to hire a writer, or someone's going to hire a writer, they're looking at not just can they write. They're looking at, can I bear to be with them? Can they, for hours and hours, can I have conflict with them? You know, can they, you know, any version of, you know, you have to be you, because any kind of inauthentic you will out. Because you're going to be working hard with a lot of people. Best to be yourself and to make that what is marketable about you. You know, I am furiously me, and sometimes it sucks because I'm not going to get those jobs that I might not need to be me. But that's okay, because those jobs will probably suck, for me at least. And when it comes to like writing, I think of it like when I write a pilot, I don't write it to sell it. Because if I try to sell it, if I think when I'm writing it, I need to sell this, I get really depressed and overwhelmed, and I want to quit because I don't know what sells. I don't think anybody really knows, and no one's looking to buy just Nevin scripts, so I can't just force the issue. So I write as an example of how I write. I always think of, at least to get myself through it, I'm writing this so that I can give it to somebody and say, I'm a good writer. You know, I can write. And by the way, you should like me because I'm cool. Oh, and I have some credits, and you know, I'm collaborative and supportive, and that totality is what makes you one of the, you know, the people who's worth ultimately thinking about hiring. Does that answer the question?
Oh, yeah, definitely. Thank you. Cool. Thank you very much.
We have, like, two more there?
Hi, you were talking earlier about breaking scripts, and it just sounds like you had a big passion for it. And I find that that it can be a difficult process. And obviously, it's kind of an obtuse question, but when you're looking at something where you have to get from point A to point B, you might even know what needs to transpire in a scene or something. Say, do you have go-tos or like things that you can kind of look to that you might want to recall in that scene? Like what
depends
directions you might take? Yeah.
Original work, I suck. I can't break. It's horrible. It's miserable. Really, really hard.
Okay.
Cool. Collaborative work or derivative work, such as adapting a book. And I've done book adaptions for feature films, and I've now done one for a TV show. Source material is great because you have something to run home to. You know, you can run home to mama, and you can go, what did the book do? If we can't figure it out, what did they do? And then you go, why? And did it work, did it not? And you start. I always try to think just creatively for me to begin. And again, I go Legos, and I start going, this piece plus that piece, binary, you know, this or that. Try to get it simple so that you can go, I'm more driven by either structure to create character and drama, or character and drama to create structure. But you kind of got to pick which side you come at. So a lot of what I end up doing is I flip it. You know, if we're having trouble breaking a scene because we need a plot point to occur, okay, well, what if we throw out the plot point and go, what's the character thing we actually need? Can we try hitting that? Because maybe we hit the character point, the problem isn't that we need to get the plot point here, it's that actually the plot isn't working, and then we should adjust. And then you go, why isn't it working? It's a whole bunch of like this derivative is the right word? It's a whole bunch of reducing, you know? Just reduce it down and build in the back of your head a whole bunch of options. So if you'd need, I'm trying to think of a reference from the show that's like, worth talking about. Okay, spoilers. The character of Raylene. The character of Raylene in the book is just an old war buddy, Takeshi Kovacs, who's a villain for no real emotionally powerful reason. So you got two problems. Plot, kind of boring if you find out the villain has no relevance to the hero. And character, villain's boring because you don't care about them. Those are really good questions to know. And actually, a lot of the work is to do that work. Is why was not as good as it could be. And so it was my idea to make Raylene the sister. We talked about older sister, younger sister, and like, you know, what is the family dynamic? But ultimately, it was either going to be he took the bullet for her, metaphorically, and saved her, and then she fell, or she took the bullet for him and saved him and then fell, talking narratively. So that when she came back into the story at the end, you are desperate to find her. You're so relieved that you find her, because you love her, because you've been laying her in the whole time. And she's this ghost taunting him as somebody he's lost, who's good. And then by the end of 107, you realize, oh my fucking God, there's a reason why you're here. It's because she wants you here, because she's the villain. And that should destroy you as an audience member. But it's all like, all the pieces are there. Yeah. But you have to be able to go and just sort of like look at it from the classic old 40,000 feet, get around inside of it, pick it apart, figure out why will it work better if you do this, and talk about it.
Cool. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Yeah, you're welcome.
All right, last one.
You spoke a little bit kind of about your interactions with people, specifically about your first script, with managers, directors, producers, things like that, and kind of how that worked out. I just wanted to know, what was it like during kind of production of Altered Carbon specifically? What was your process and what was your communication like with the directors,
crazy,
producers, and everything happening
intense
during production?
Awesome. Ruthlessly collaborative and just exhausting. But it was like, all of that is good, you know? Because also, we did a lot of like R&D writing where we would be like, we're not sure what's going to work. And we're still finding it. And we had all this time. But we also refused to not have it be great. And so we're just constantly grinding it out and trying to make it work, which means sometimes you're working with a director. Sometimes I'm working with Lita. Sometimes, you know, like, I live in L.A. And I did not, they didn't want to pay to have me move to Vancouver. And I didn't want to go live in Vancouver because I'm married and I love my wife. But, you know, part of what happened, like, there was a period where I was in Vancouver often again. Like, I'd go up for 2 or 3 days. Sit with Lita, or sit with the director, or sit with the other producers, and get notes. You know, here, go rewrite this, and go do that. And then be like, yeah, we're not going to do it. or go rewrite this, and then, well, we can't do that now, but we're going to try a different version, go change it, and, you know, constant revisioning. And then there was also a period of time where I was in LA after the pilot was shot and was being cut with Lita at a cafe in Studio City, basically, where we were going through all of the eps and thinking, like, all right, what can we do better? How can we change it? Doing like 3 weeks of that. So like not a 9-to-5 job, but like a 10-to-2 job. And just constant revision there. And while also there's a cut coming in, and none of which I have any control over, but for the words, I have control over that and I can impact that. And then when she went back to Vancouver to continue doing the physical production for the rest of the show, my day usually was some version of, I would wake up and I would do nothing for most of the day, waiting to get work. And often my work would come near the end of the day, because that's when her day would be sorting out. And so I'd get like a call around 6 or 7, and all right, so got to turn around a draft for tomorrow, or do this scene, this way, that way, that way. And the one thing I am very, very, very clear on when I'm working with anybody, and I kind of rely on it from the people I work with, is, okay, so the point of the scene is this, the character's gonna do that, and then that, and then why are we doing that? Okay, and the transition you want is this, done. And if you can just get it down and have faith that you're good, and they have faith that you're good, then you can take those notes and you can actually force somebody to give you good notes. Not that Lee doesn't give good notes, but that if you're ever in a situation where you've got to execute something and you're not sure, you need to correct it. Like I made a big mistake a while ago in my career, I didn't do that work, and it basically got me fired, because it's my job as a writer to not, if I don't know something and I'm not being told it and I know I don't know it, I need to go find out. And so a lot of my job was clarity, intent. Future goal. And just go for it. Get as much of that out from the person who can make that decision, and then go execute it.
Wow. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
So I have one last question to kind of end up with, and that's, if you had the chance to talk to yourself 10 years in the past... What would the advice, you know, from what you know now?
Oh man!
What would you be telling yourself back
10
then?
Years ago? So I'm 37, I'd be 27. Have a little bit more faith. Have a little bit more confidence. You know, like by 27, I was like about ready to quit. You know, and really convinced it didn't matter if I was any good or not. It just wouldn't happen. It didn't matter because, you know, I'm my dad's son, and I haven't made it yet. You know, and didn't. I don't know why I didn't. I don't really know why I didn't, and I'm glad I didn't. Just having that gumption and that grit, which a lot of any job, doesn't matter if it's creative or not, but you just kind of have to be willing to do it. And then just keep doing it. And the thing I said earlier, like, be the best version of yourself. Like, I had that realization through a lot of failure and internal, like, you know, wanting to quit over and over again. And deciding that the one thing that always worked was when I was fucking me. You know, when I walked into a room and I didn't try to sell something, I sold the fact that I want to be here and I love telling stories. And I kind of like the thing that I'm here to talk to you about. And you seem to like something I wrote, so that's a really good place to begin. And just treat it like play. Treat it like fun. And that helped me get through being really depressed and insecure about every single thing I wrote. And I still hated everything I wrote. But I'd go back and say, like, write more. I still don't write enough. You know, like I write a lot professionally. I don't write a lot for me. And I haven't written a new pilot or a new script since 2015. And that's my fault. I should. I haven't had to. I've been tired. I've been busy. But I also really should. And that industriousness, you know. I talk about Lita, the hardest working person I ever met in my life. Even more, like, my dad worked hard. She works the hardest I've ever seen. And that is why she is successful. She's talented, and she's creative, she's artistic, she's got great references, you know? But why is she successful? Because she works harder than everybody else. And that's it. I mean, at the end of the day, I really have seen mediocrity rises if the work ethic is there and you become good. So you don't have to be the natural talent. You have to do it. Keep doing it through failure. You know, like, fail a lot, you know, fuck up a lot, because that's actually going to teach you how to do it better. And that the fear of failure will drive you. Fear is useful. You know, chase it. You know.
That's a fantastic place to leave it. I thank you guys for all coming. Round of applause for you guys. Thank you to NYFA, New York Film Academy, for hosting us this week, and it's been great to be here. And Nevin Densham, thank you for coming on the show.
Thank you very much for having me. Yeah. Appreciate it. This was fun.
And join us again next month. We'll be doing this again. So please come back. And until then, right on.